As we move more inferiorly in terms of our discussion of the joints, we get to the most superficial as well as the most complex of the joints, synovial joints of the body, and that's the knee. If you think about where individuals have pain or troubles in terms of their joints, knee often comes up as one of the more frequently damaged areas. So let's talk about what the knee joint actually is. And it's really a combo, similar to what we had in terms of the elbow, of three different joints. Now you're going to have the two femoro-tibial articulations. You will have the medial, this is the lateral, and this is the medial, where you have the condyles articulating, the femoral condyles articulating with the tibial condyles, as well as the articulation between the patella and the femur. So right here you can see that the patella has been reflected off, so you can see the inside of the knee joint. But all of these three different joints are going to be within one articular capsule. Now, what type of joint is this? We call this a complex or modified hinge joint. So think about, from what we've discussed before, what actions can occur at a hinge joint. That's right, only flexion and extension can occur here. So let's talk about flexion and extension in the knee joint because it's slightly different than other joints in the body. All right, so you can see here in terms of the model, flexion is actually occurring in a posterior direction, where extension still is returned to anatomical position. So that's a key point that I want to make sure that you understand when we're talking flexion in terms of the knee joint, that leg is moving posteriorly. So important difference between other areas of the body. Now, one other thing that I want to note, when we talk about a modified hinge joint, that means that it can slightly move in other directions. In this particular case, there is slight medial and lateral rotation. So when you're standing upright, if you think about it, when you're standing upright, say if you're teaching in front of a class for a couple of hours, your muscles could get really fatigued. So you want to be able to relax those muscles but still be able to stand upright. So when you're fully extended, your knee will slightly medially rotate in order to kind of lock the knee into position and allow for those muscles to relax just a little bit. So in particular, those quadricep muscles. So there is a little bit of medial rotation. Now when you want to be able to flex the knee, say if you want to start walking away from something, what will happen is your popliteus muscle will contract. That will allow for lateral rotation of the knee joint. And remember, these are all very slight movements, so very slight lateral rotation to allow for flexion of the knee joint to occur. Okay? So that's what we mean in terms of a modified hinge joint. All right, so before we get into the ligaments, I want to talk about the importance of the muscles and the muscle tendons in this region. So in terms, if you think about in terms of the fit of the bones, the tibial condyles are extremely shallow. So really those tendons and ligaments are playing the main role in terms of stability. Now in terms of what's playing the biggest role, that's going to be tendons. Specifically your quadriceps femoris tendon. Okay, so let's write that down and make sure we remember this. So quadriceps femoris. So that complex of four big muscles on the anterior portion of your thigh. If you have well-conditioned quadriceps femoris muscle and tendon, that can offset any type of damage that you have in many of these ligaments we're talking about here. So that's why a lot of the conditioning goes into those particular muscles. But I don't want to give you the impression that these ligaments don't play a big role too. They're also going to be very important. Now this first one we're going to discuss is the patellar ligament. And it's actually, it's referred to as the patellar ligament, but that's really a misnomer. It's really a continuation of the quadriceps femoris tendon, okay? So it's from the point where, as we recall, the patella is that sesamoid bone. So the patella is a sesamoid bone, meaning that it forms within the quadriceps femoris tendon. All right? So the part of the tendon that continues from the patella down to the tibial tuberosity of the tibia, That's referred to as the patellar ligament. All right, so distal part of that quadriceps tendon. Also, as you can note in these pictures here, you're going to have a fibular collateral ligament. And a lot of times, particularly clinically, you hear this referred to as the lateral collateral ligament. All right, but we know that's going to be lateral because the fibula is always lateral. So you can see that here, a fairly rope-like extracapsular ligament. And then on the opposite side, you have the tibial collateral ligament. All right. So from the femur to the tibia. This one is significantly weaker than the fibular collateral ligament. And anytime you have a weaker ligament, there's more often injured. Also very important to note is that the TCL is attached to the medial meniscus. And we'll talk about the medial meniscus more in just a moment, but you can see that right here. So there's a connection. So oftentimes, if the TCL is damaged, the medial meniscus will be as well. So recall in terms of our conversation of what a meniscus is, this is going to be composed of fibrocartilage, all right? So anytime you have cartilage, you know we're talking avascular. So without blood supply, that means if there's damage to this particular area, it's very hard for this to heal as compared to other areas of the body. So your medial meniscus, you can see here, attached to your TCL. And then the stronger and more circular lateral meniscus. Now, the lateral meniscus has a bit more mobility, so it's much less likely to be damaged than the medial meniscus. So if we recall, this is a perfect place to have a meniscus because it's sitting within these very, very shallow tibial condyles, so allowing for a better fit for these large femoral condyles. All right, so continuing on, so we're talking now intraarticular, so within the articular capsule, we have two main ligaments that I want to make sure that you understand. You've probably heard of these before, particularly if you are into sports or have played any sports. Your ACL and your PCL, so anterior cruciate ligament. So you can see the anterior cruciate ligament here in the more anterior view, and your posterior cruciate ligament, which you can see more clearly in a posterior view, as the names would indicate. So think about it. If you have ever heard of either of these ligaments, which one have you probably heard of more? Which one comes up more? That's going to be your ACL. And the reason that is because it is significantly weaker and more often damaged. Now, important to note, and this is sometimes confused, a lot of some textbooks, traditional textbooks, had that the ACL was attached to both the tibial collateral ligament and the medial meniscus. It actually isn't. It's very closely associated, but they're not actually attached. But oftentimes, those three components are damaged together. And if you've ever heard the term terrible triad, or unhappy triad, what's being damaged is the TCL, the medial meniscus, and your ACL. Now, oftentimes, only these two will be damaged, but if all three are damaged together in one particular injury, that's the terrible triad. So if you think about somebody running into your knee from a lateral side, that force is going to move all the way to the more medial side and damage those things that are attached or closely associated to one another. All right, PCL, you may have heard of this particular ligament as well. It is considerably stronger than its partner on the anterior side. And this is really important in terms of actually when you're walking downhill or walking downstairs. This is the ligament that's keeping that femur from moving too far from where it should be. Okay? So it's really keeping it in check, allowing for the appropriate amount of flexion and extension, but not allowing for that femur to get too far out of place. So it's important in terms of locomotion. It's less likely to be damaged. If it is damaged, it has bigger implications than the anterior cruciate ligament.